In Tibetan Buddhism, there are many deities and many practices that stop magic and exorcism. I'm sorry, and spirit possession and spirit affliction. But there is no rituals to create that. Buddhism doesn't have any rituals to create magic for others. Because Buddha never taught things that harm. But that doesn't deny the fact there are other people who practice the dark arts to harm us. And even not even harm us through the dark arts, there are just evil negative spirits or negative portals in which they can enter to harm us. So Vajrayani is one of the most effective deities to chase them away. So she has a slightly wrathful face to protect us. So her wrathful face is what is not in us. That's why earlier he explained there's two expressions. It's wrathful bliss. So her expressions like this is like, look here, it's like she's smiling and very blissed out, but at the same time there's a slight grimace. Why? She's smiling at us, but at beings that disturb us, she's showing a wrathful face like, don't disturb my student. Stay away. That's her expression. So her face is not so fierce like Cetra. Actually, it's very gentle and very beautiful. Female, beautiful lady, like a mother. And but at the same time, there's protection. So when we do Vajrayani's rituals, it is very powerful for stopping possession. So we're not just talking about a deity that afflicts you, that hangs around you. We're not just talking about an evil spirit or evil deity that just hangs around you. We're talking about some of these evil ones that actually enter you. So when they enter you, Vajrayani's ritual is very powerful to expel them. So her wrathful expression is not something we should be afraid of. It is something that actually we should be very appreciative of. Why? She's showing us, I'll protect you. Oh, very powerful. You understand that? And she stands in a very powerful stance. Very, very powerful stance. And her left leg stands very strongly. You bring the tatsu. Bring the bigger tatsu. Just very powerful stance like this. Her legs are open completely. Her legs are in a very powerful stance, showing that she has two very powerful actions. One is, she steps on ignorance and hatred. It is a black man under her that's actually deity Ishwara. Ishwara offered himself to her. So she steps on his forehead and the back of his head, representing ignorance and hatred. So she's stepping on that means if you do her practice, she will overcome your ignorance. Also, those who have hatred towards you, you can overcome them by her power. That's one. Second is, her other hand, her other feet is stepping on a lady on her breast. Because people in this world are very attracted to ladies' breasts. Ladies' breasts, although it's wrong, represents sex. Because people are attracted, that's why a woman wears a cleavage or shows something, everybody looks. You know, they look, they admire, they like. So when she steps on the lady's breast, it represents what? Through her practice, she will destroy desire. And all the negativities that come from desire. So that's like that. And her hands, standing up, holding a skull cup. The skull cup represents, that inside contains substances that are sacred. When she drinks this sacred substance, it represents that she is in the meditation of emptiness all the time. So Vajrayani never leaves emptiness, never leaves meditation. She's always in meditation consistently. And her face is facing us. I do not be wise. It's very hard to promote, to denote that, to show that. But her face is facing us, meaning great compassion. Her eyes looking up, one, and looking the other one, looking down. And what happens is we don't draw that because it looks crooked. But actually, she's a Buddha, so it doesn't look weird. Looking at you to tell you where she's going to take you, looking up to tell you where. Where is Buddha? So going to Kinchara Paradise is symbolic of going to Buddhahood. So she's saying, I will take you to Buddhahood. The third eye represents penetration of all things to be known, omniscience. She has an omniscient. Somewhere we have a sacred central channel. The central channel starts here
and it goes to our secret organ for male and female, the same. Our urinal opening. Our urinal opening for male and female. The tip of that, it starts there, and it goes around, and it goes along our spine, and it goes along our back, and it goes around here, and it's between the skull and the skin, and it opens up here. So those that their psychic channel, the central psychic channel is open, it's represented by the third eye. The third eye, because when that channel opens, you gain clairvoyance. So the third eye represents seeing into the future, past and present, unobstructed. Okay? Then her body is red. Why? Red represents desire. Red represents grasping, attractiveness, wanting. Red is the psychological color for attraction. So her beautiful red body represents our era, the era of grasping toward physical attachment or material things. It isn't just sense. I want, I want, I want. And this wanting is what creates a lot of suffering for us. So her red body represents what? When you worship her, her main pervasive action is to help you purify this grasping toward material objects or samsara. Okay? She's completely naked, meaning what? She breaks all conventions. What conventions? Convention representing wrong projection. Things should be this way, should be this way, this way. When we have wrong projection and we act upon the wrong projection, our suffering can be better. So wrong projection, wrong idea, or wrong projection of an idea or a concept, and acting out of that makes us suffer. For example, if someone tells me, oh, Paul is a very bad person, and he's very evil, and I don't like him, and you got to be careful, he also steals. And let's say JP said that to me, but it's not true. But if I act towards that toward him, I'm very mean to him, I don't like him, and I treat him badly, right? I collect a lot of negative karma. Why? Because that's not true. Even if it's true, I still collect negative karma. What I'm saying is, I'm collecting negative karma out of my wrong perception of him. So like that, that's a very small example. We have the wrong perception of attachment, about life, about food, about what brings us happiness. Because of this wrong attachment, we act in relations to it. That creates a lot of negative karma. So when we do Vajrayana's practice, it breaks this concept completely. Okay? And she wears 50 human skulls. The 50 human skulls is a tantric symbology of the Buddha's speech. 32 consonants, 18 vowels. Buddha's speech is Sanskrit. So Sanskrit sacred language has 18 vowels and 32 consonants. I mixed up, sorry. So she wears 50 skulls representing she has perfected Buddha's speech. Buddha's speech is in her. That means when she talks one voice, people of all levels hear the Dharma on their level, in their language, according to their capacity. She speaks only once. Okay?
And then her hair is not tied up like other deities. She has a cap and a vajra on top. This cap and vajra represents her indestructibility. She has a cheap Buddhahood, but her hair is completely loose. Most deities are tied up. Her hair is loose, representing free from samsara. Nothing is bound. Okay? Then in this hand, she holds a knife. On this hand, she holds a knife. And this knife is a cemetery knife. You bring my stuff. The color of my mother. This represents a cemetery knife. Why? In ancient India, the cemeteries are not like ours here.
In ancient India, the cemeteries are where we actually take the corpses, and the monks and priests come and do prayers. And they chop it up very finely. And they do prayers, they offer to animals to eat. And when they offer to animals to eat, they pray that may this person use their body as a last act of prayer. Why? We have nothing left but our body. So, to maybe new people who don't understand, it may seem gruesome, but actually, if you think about it, it's very virtuous. Very, very virtuous. So in the cemeteries in India, they have a special knife with a hook where they actually cut the person, and the hook actually takes out the intestines and the bowels. So this is called a cemetery knife. She carries the cemetery knife. This cemetery knife that she carries, why does she carry a cemetery knife? Because it represents practice the Dhamma in the end, where you all end up in the cemetery. So the money you have doesn't help. The food you have doesn't help. The attachments you have, the lovers you have doesn't help. The cars and the material items you have doesn't help. You will end up in the cemetery. So what really matters at the time of truth? What's the time of truth? Death. What helps you at the time of truth? The time of truth is your Dharma practice of death, the mind transformation of death. Because at the time of death, what goes with you? Your mind. So if your mind's been transformed, you have a good rebirth. If your mind's not transformed, you have a bad rebirth. So what happens is when she shows you the cemetery knife, it represents to remind you, develop compassion, develop wisdom, develop great, great, great loving kindness. Why? When you're dying or when you're dead, what will help you? She's asking you. And she shows you the knife at the same time, it's representing what? Representing what? All those who worship Vajrayana will be free of obstructors and demons and enemies and problems and people who want harm. She has the full protection to protect you. So this knife, what we use a knife for? Cutting things. So when she holds that knife, it represents protection from harm. So those who do not Vajrayana practice very strongly and well will be protected from harm. Then she holds a staff. The staff has 62 qualities. The staff represents the complete Hiruka Mandala, the Hiruka teachings. Why? In her tantra, female rule. Female represents wisdom. Male represents method. So in her tantra, female rules, but Hiruka's with her. So holding the staff meaning Hiruka's always with her. When you practice her, you're practicing Hiruka or Shakyamuni. No difference. This is the staff of Vajrayana. This represents the Buddhas of the past, present, and future. Okay, so she'll hold this in the crook of her arm, like that, literally, right? Actually, it's like this, but in paintings, they put it like that, or statues, because it looks iconography more beautiful. It's actually like this on her left shoulder of the crook. And she holds a skull cup containing sacred liquid, which she drinks of. When we drink of this, we gain immortality. Immortality means a state of no death, but it's not Chinese immortal. It means Buddha. Why the only being that never dies is a Buddha. Okay? Then, along with that, she holds a cemetery knife in the book. This knife cuts you. Okay? This knife cuts you. Stand. So how they usually do it is, they cut you here, they take the brains out, and they cut you from here down to your crotch. And you gotta cut across, open it up, and they use this one to hook your bowels out. Then ancient India, you're already dead. What's more gruesome? Put you in the box under the ground, the worms eat you. You think, would you like to be in the ground where the worms eat you? How about they bury you, didn't really die yet? Yeah, this is easier. Or how they put you in a vat and they burn you, the fire. What's the difference? If we're scared of being cut, we should be scared of burning burn, cremation. If we're scared of being burned, I would be more scared to be born in a box. I mean, for, you know, like, how many years you're in a box under the ground? Very scary. The point is, death is scary. It's final. So we need to do something now. So this one takes all it out. That's why it's called a cemetery knife. So she holds this like this. Very powerful symbology. Very, very powerful. So when we practice her, we can overcome that. Overcome. Okay? Now what happens is this is, those who practice Vajrayana, there are three levels of practitioners. The lowest, laziest practitioner but has faith, guru devotion, does her sadhana and mantra and does the tok and holds the vows. Five conditions. The lowest practitioner holds the vows, has guru devotion, and does her sadhana, does her mantra, and does tok offerings. Five. The lowest practitioner. Within seven lifetimes, you will ascend to Vajrayana. So that means after you die now, you will be reborn in a place where you can learn her tantra and meet her lama again and receive her initiation and practice and then reach another level. The next life, another level, another level. But within seven lifetimes, you will take rebirth from your paradise. The medium practitioner, bring my Vajra bell and Dhamma.
What about the Dhamma rule? What about it?
She holds it.
She doesn't hold a Dhamma rule. She has it on her Kanaka.
What does it represent?
Emptiness. Realization of emptiness. The Dhamma rule, the sound, comes from nowhere, goes nowhere. It's produced from objects that are supported by impermanence. So therefore, the Dhamma rule represents the sound of impermanence. So when you're dying, you hear the Dhamma rule sound, it means when you ascend to Vajrayana's heaven, you will receive the teachings that I told you.
When we offer the Dhamma Rupa sound to the Buddhas, it's represented as like merit to achieve emptiness. The medium practitioner, okay? Just make a prayer in the future, you can bless life. For the medium practitioner, medium, same conditions, but you do your practice more sincerely, you have guru devotion. Very important, do the mantra as well. When you're dying, instead of seeing darkness and fear, you will visit. Along with hearing these sounds, you will also hear male and female chanting. And you will see a bright red light, and you will see her coming, holding you, embracing you, kissing you, and as you're being kissed and hold held by your mother, by your knee, you ascend. She takes your consciousness to take rebirth in Kishan paradise. That's the medium practitioner. So you will not die in fear. You will not die in confusion. You will die with sounds, with lights, with beautiful music, beautiful singing, in the presence of her coming to teach you. Remember that. Medium practitioner. Highest practitioner. Now listen very carefully, because these are things I don't usually talk about. Highest practitioner, and this time remember, so that I don't have to repeat again and again in the future. You should know. Highest practitioner in this life, they have very strong Buddha devotion. Buddha devotion means doing what your Guru says, according to practice, not upsetting your Guru. Things that upset your Guru is your attachments. Always fighting, not cooperating. Buddha devotion, doing her sadhana correctly, doing her mantra, holding the vows, and last but not least is doing the soul offerings correctly. The highest practitioner can get that very well and does the meditation strongly. In this life, without having to leave your body behind, your body, whatever age, whatever sex you are, however old you are, whatever condition, the cells of your body will transform instead of a rainbow. You will attain a rainbow body. And your body will turn to that rainbow body, the nature of Ajivini's body. And your very body, without leaving behind, will fly and ascend to her heaven. Her tantra is very special. Why? She's always shown in poses of flying. Bring the other small Ajivini that's flying. All her tantra, she has many different forms, always showing her flying. Why? It is symbolic of your body transforming. So, what's special about her tantra, that's very different than other tantras, is every other tantra to ascend to their paradise, you must die. Shed your body. Hers, the highest practitioner of the body, will change. Will transform. So your very body, this is her flying, this is another form. Her completely flying. No need that one. So what happens is, it represents what? The highest practitioner of Ajivini's tantra. Highest! The highest, huh? Highest practitioner of Ajivini, their body, the molecules, will become very subtle and transform. Earth, air, wind, and fire to a rainbow body. The rainbow body will become very light. You will be able to fly. You will be able to ascend. So you will take the rainbow body and ascend earth, heaven, directly with your body without leaving anything behind. That will be the highest practitioner. So there are three levels of people who can enter. So for the highest person who exerts their self toward Dharma in this life and lets go of the ego, they'll have a rainbow body. Jalu. The medium practitioner in the Bardo, instead of being hanging around for 49 days, upon death, you will see her ship taking. The most laziest practitioner, but does the best that he can, is still very lazy, seven of times. Does everybody understand that? It's a specialty. That's why her practice is very beneficial in this life. Why? Compared to others, it's much more easier. The meditation is simpler, but the benefits are tremendous. Tremendous. So you'll be worshipping a Buddha, collecting a lot of merits, and preparing for your future life. That's why I recommend people to always make their statue buy her statue, make offerings, make prostrations, make water offerings, offer jewelry, whatever you can. Well, you're creating the causes for yourself to get a rainbow life. And at the same time, in this life, you're protected from spirits. Very much. We should get her statue and make it as beautiful as possible. And every single day, we should make full-length prostrations to her. Full-length. Let's say there are statues there. Every day we should make full-length prostrations of Mahi Dini. Every single day. If we can do 100,000, it's excellent. Every single day we should do that. We should make offerings to her every single day. And when we make offerings of Mahi Dini, we say, but I like Tara, but I like Manjushri, but I like Tsongkhapa. No. All the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and deities dissolve into Mahi Dini. And she is their essence. And we worship her, pray to her. She's the same as all of them. Why? How can the Buddhas have jealousy and bias? Impossible. But she's a practice we don't show other people. It should be very secret. Why? Look at her body, look at her form. People don't understand. Look how you feel about her. You don't understand. So other people feel like that. So you're not hiding her because you're doing something wrong, but protecting her. She's very simple. Very, very simple. Therefore, that's why I say, those who have connection to me have connection to her. Why? Because I promote her to you guys. I'm here in Malaysia to promote her. Promote her, why? It would be the most suitable practice for people like us. What's people like us? Don't put enough time in Dharma. We love to have our attachments. Relatively lazy. Don't make a lot of time for Dharma practice. She's very friendly. Is that a criticism or that's the truth of our nature at this moment? Very simple. So what can we do with her right now? We should have her image and make offerings, make prayers, supplicate, circumambulate as much as possible. And we should make many images of her to give away to people. So in fact, you think, but I don't have a chance to make her statue yet, I don't have a chance to raise money. No, by promoting KH, by doing Dharma work and volunteering, you're already creating people to come to her. Why? Eventually they're going to do her practice when they're in our organization. Even the name of our organization is called Kichara House. Kichara and Kichara is the name of her paradise. And why do I call it the house? Because it's more friendly. More friendly. Also, we use paradise for this for the library, so we have to register under another name. But Kichara is it. And in fact, our symbolism in our organization. Thank you. Our symbolism, you see this everywhere, is this letter, right? Here or here. This is her sacred syllable, her sacred representation in letter form. So this is Vajrayani's mind in a form of a letter. In meditation, we have to use this. I can't explain it at this time. So this symbol represents. So everything about our organization represents her. Everything. Everything about her represents Vajrayani. Isn't that unique? So our organization is focused toward her and her practice. Why? Let me repeat. It's much more easier than other temples. So for us lazy, sneaky people, she's perfect for me, she's perfect for you. That's what my guru told me. He says, you guys are lazy, and you don't want to do a lot of effort. That's why she's very good for you. I remember that 30 years ago he told us. 30 plus, about 25. She's very unique. Everything about her is protection, love, collecting a merit, and ascending to Kichara paradise. Everything about her is love, like a mother or a child. Why she looks like you. Great love. Take you somewhere wonderful. And protection, her knife, her fierce face, and her skulls, her wrathful energy is stay away from my disciple. Don't disturb your practice. You know. Why? No force on this earth can overcome Mahi Dini. She's a river. No force on this river. And she's excellent for exorcism. So when we create her chapel, her image, or anything having to do with it, we are connecting people to this type of energy. Very fortunate. Very, very fortunate. We're connecting people to this energy. So in the future, I will arrange that this initiation is given either by myself or one of my teachers. So that the students who have stuck on, loyal, did their practice, will receive it. Why? Those with those qualities, they do this practice, they'll gain themselves. Those who are not loyal, not stable, don't listen, don't practice guru devotion, it's very difficult to get this practice. Why? They won't achieve anything. They won't follow instruction. So before you get this, you have to prove your worth. Very simple, you have to prove your worth. I mean, that's logical, isn't it? You're not going to pass a family heirloom to your son's girlfriend that hangs around for a few months on you. You're going to pass your heirloom to someone he's going to marry and make sure she's going to stay around, right? Same thing, why would you pass some sacred initiation to someone who's flippant, run here, run there, don't know if they want, don't know if they stay, don't know if they do? Why would you do that? It hurts them. Very powerful practice.